There are a lot of mysteries in physics, right? Like, we don't know what dark matter is, we don't know what dark energy is, we don't know why the neutrino has mass, what happened at the earliest moments of the Big Bang, and et cetera, et cetera. I could just keep going on and on about modern day physics mysteries. A couple hundred years ago in the 1800s, the big physics mysteries were about electricity and magnetism, and basically nobody had any idea of what was going on. There were just all these experiments and ideas floating around, but everyone was confused. Everyone was just, they just had no idea what was going on. Like, take electricity. Ancient peoples had known about electricity for millennia. We've known about the phenomena of electricity. There are certain animals, like electric eels, if you touch them, you get a shock. If you rubbed on like a fabric for a while, then you could shock someone. They knew that lightning, it kind of sort of looked like electricity. They knew that amber, if you rubbed it, then it could have these strange properties where stuff could stick to it. It was so, you know, just weird. And then as scientists began performing more and more experiments with electricity in the late 1700s, early 1800s, it just went out of control. We had no clue what was going on. We were starting to get some sense of the properties of electricity. Like, we were able to realize that electricity comes in two kinds that we called positive and negative. We knew that electricity could flow down a wire or stay contained inside of an object like a battery. We knew that if you had two metal spheres and you electrically charged them, then the spheres would either repel or attract, depending on if you filled them with the same charges or opposite charges. It took a long time to figure out that natural electricity, like the electricity found in animals, and if you take like a corpse and zap it and it twitches, like, there's obviously electricity associated with bodies and anatomy. We figured out that the electricity associated with living creatures was the same electricity that we were generating and storing in batteries. And when we developed devices for generating electric current, we realized it's all the same kind of electricity. We realized that lightning is a form of electricity. This is Benjamin Franklin's infamous experiment of flying a kite in a thunderstorm and all that. So we were starting to list the properties of electricity. But beyond that, beyond just doing experiments and recording it and announcing it to the world, we weren't really understanding electricity. We weren't understanding what it came from. We weren't understanding how it influenced the environment around it. We didn't understand it as a force and how it was generated and how other objects responded to it. And then parallel to that was our growing understanding and misunderstanding and wish we could understanding of magnetism. Again, magnetism has been known to humanity since forever in the form of lodestones, these magical rocks that you can dig out of the ground and then metal bits stick to them, or compasses. We have been using compasses for a very long time by now. But again, this seems like magical. Like, here's a magical rock that will always point in the same direction. Like, who? This isn't a fantasy story. This is real life. Or, like, if you sit and look at a compass, it looks like magic. And as scientists like Ampère, like Faraday, were beginning to explore magnetism, they were finding that magnetism was very strangely linked to electricity, and that these phenomena seem related, seemed connected, but they didn't really understand why. For example, Faraday had a couple experiments where his most famous one is if he took a metal hoop and he wound one wire on one side and another wire on the other, and then he flipped on a switch and allowed a current to flow through the first wire, very briefly, he'd get a current through the second wire, even though the wires weren't connected. They could also do experiments like if you take a loop of wire and you wiggle a magnet around inside of the loop, it generates an electric current. Or you can take an electric current, like an electrified wire, and it will deflect where a compass points. So all this was getting very, very strange. All this was getting very odd. It seemed like in the early and mid 1800s, that electricity and magnetism were connected, but nobody could figure out how or why, and that there were so many, this ridiculous variety of experiments, this variety of properties that people were starting to record, and none of it made any sense. Nobody understood it until James Clerk Maxwell. James Clerk Maxwell was a physicist, mathematician, all-around super genius living in the mid-1800s in Scotland. To give you an example of just how smart he was, when he was 14, he published a paper in a journal providing a mathematical proof. So he was a published author, a published mathematician at age 14. When I was 14, I was just trying to beat the latest Zelda game, okay? So Maxwell definitely has one up on just about all of us. He was certainly, certainly a genius. Now, Maxwell, he was working on another problem, which was color vision. And in fact, he invented the color photograph, by the way, when he heard about all this electricity and magnetism stuff, and he decided to figure it out. And that's exactly what he did. When you're someone like Maxwell and you're a super genius of the highest order, you just sit down and you think really hard and you come up with a solution because that's how your brain works. He just envisioned the mathematical solution. And what he did in order to solve, to take all these experiments, all these phenomena, all these properties about electricity and magnetism that humanity had been grappling with for millennia, Maxwell realized that they can all be summarized by four simple equations. I do need to say he didn't write them down as four equations. He wrote them down as 20 equations. They were later simplified to four, but all the essence is there is that he was able to find a compact set of equations that described everything. Now we call these Maxwell's equations, the equations of electromagnetism. And what he realized, his key insight, was that electricity and magnetism were two sides of the same coin. That you can't think about electricity without thinking about magnetism and vice versa. They are united. There is a single force called electromagnetism. And this single force expresses itself in different ways. And by uniting electricity and magnetism under a single force, he was able to explain the apparent connectedness. He realized, for example, that if you have a changing electric field, you can get a magnetic field. And if you have a changing magnetic field, you have an electric field. So that you can create electric forces from magnetic forces, and you can create magnetic forces from electric forces. These are all interconnected. And so with that compact set of equations, he totally revolutionized physics. He solved a problem that had been troubling physicists for at least 100 years, since physicists had been working hard on the questions of electricity and magnetism. He did it all. He just did it. He just solved it, because that's what Maxwell does. And Maxwell was able to do this because I am convinced that James Clerk Maxwell was not really born in the 1800s. I am convinced that James Clerk Maxwell is a scientist from the future, from the 20th century, from the 21st century, maybe the 22nd century, who first solved the time travel and then went back in time into the 1800s to explain how the electromagnetic forces work. Maxwell's work was revolutionary. Maxwell's work was ahead of its time. Maxwell's work was beyond what any of his contemporaries, anyone else was thinking at the time. You know, we like to think of Einstein as a super genius and capable of thinking thoughts that no one else could think. Maxwell was Einstein's Einstein. He was the pre-Einstein. He was Einstein 1.0. He was that kind of revolutionary thinker. And what he did to think like a future scientist and apply it to problems in the 1800s with electricity and magnetism were two things. One was this whole unification idea. In fact, we call Maxwell's work the second great unification in physics. The first was Newton's realization that the gravity on the Earth is the same as the gravity in the heavens. That was a major unification idea. The next one came with Maxwell, who realized that electricity and magnetism are two sides of the same coin. Unification is how physics is done. Unification, if you've ever heard of string theory is carrying on Maxwell's legacy and trying to unite the forces. Maxwell saw electricity over here and magnetism over here and realized that they are the same thing. The second thing that Maxwell did to think like a future scientist was to introduce the concept of the field. Now, I just mentioned in Maxwell's equations that like changing magnetic fields can create electric fields and vice versa. Today, the concept of the field, the language of a field, the discussion of a field is totally, not special. Like here's an electric field, there's a magnetic field. Like we're used to this kind of language. Nobody was used to this kind of language in the 1850s and 1860s. Nobody except Maxwell. Maxwell realized that when you have an electric charge, like here, I give you an electric charge, that this creates something called an electric field. This electric field permeates all of space, has strength and direction and properties depending on the electric charge itself. And what this electric field does is tell other charges how to move. So if you're another charge and you're floating around, you're like, hey, how am I going to react to that electric charge over there? All I have to do is ask the field, how strong is the field here? What direction is the field pointing? And that will tell me how to move. And same for that magnetic field. Today, we take it for granted that fields exist. Today, we take it for granted that fields are a way to understand our natural world. Nobody took it for granted back then. Okay, you had like Michael Faraday, who was playing with electricity in the early 1800s, and he was like sprinkling iron filings around a bar magnet and looking at all these little lines, and he was envisioning lines of force. But Michael Faraday had like no mathematical training. Seriously, he barely knew trigonometry. So he couldn't advance it any further. He was like wondering about four lines or something. Maxwell made it a mathematical thing. Maxwell introduced it into his equations. He used this idea of the field in order to explain the behavior of electricity and magnetism. And he introduced a concept that was truly revolutionary. Today in physics, it's all about the field. In fact, today in physics, we understand that the field is the primary physical object. That's right. An electric field or electromagnetic field is more real than particles. These are just manifestations of the field. It's all about the field. This is modern physics. Fields and unification. That is modern physics. Here is Maxwell introducing modern physics into the world. He is introducing the concept of the field. He is uniting forces, and he was doing it. He was so ahead of his time that when he wrote like three papers in a book, that's all he wrote on electromagnetism, and they went on to other problems. Everyone was so blown away. They knew he was right, but it seemed so advanced it was scary, and it took years after him before the community came around and said, okay, now I get it. Like, your ideas are so ahead of our time, we actually have to wait until to catch up, just like Einstein, just like Einstein's idea of general relativity. So right there, Maxwell is a scientist from the future. I'm convinced they grew that outrageous beard to hide his identity, but he is from the future and he time traveled, and then he gave everyone electromagnetism. But Maxwell didn't stop there. Maxwell didn't stop there. He didn't just unite electricity and magnetism. He found something absolutely amazing. Something he wasn't even predicting. Something he wasn't even planning on were hidden in the equations of electromagnetism. You see, he realized, one, that there's this field, the field of electricity, the field of magnetism. Any magnet, any electric charge creates these fields. And these fields are real dynamical entities. These are physical things. It's not just a mathematical trick. It's not just a way to solve a problem. These are real physical entities. That was Maxwell's insight. The electric and magnetic fields are physical entities. And you realize, oh, if I have a changing electric field, it creates a magnetic field. And if I have a changing magnetic field, it creates a electric field. So I wonder if I could set it up just right so the electric field is always changing, and this makes an always changing magnetic field, which makes an always changing electric field, and back and forth and back and forth. What would this look like? It would look like a wave. It would look like a wave of electricity and magnetism, constantly working off of each other. A changing electric field generates a magnetic field in front of it. The changing magnetic field makes a changing electric field, and then they leapfrog past each other and can propagate through space. Maxwell saw that in his equations because he was super smart. He's like, oh, okay, so I wonder what this wave of electricity and magnetism, I wonder how fast it goes. You know, you got the speed of sound, you got the speed of waves in water. I wonder how fast these electric and magnetic fields waves will go. He calculated the speed based on the strength of electricity and the strength of magnetism, which we knew from experiments. He plugged it in, and he got the speed of light. Right there. We had known the speed of light. Parallel to all these discussions about the exploration of electricity, the exploration of magnetism, there was the exploration of light. People were wondering, what is light? What are its properties? How do we explain it? One of the things we had measured was its speed. And the speed of electromagnetic waves turned out to be the speed of light. Maxwell discovered light. If light hadn't existed in our universe before then, Maxwell would have been the inventor of light. He realized that light is waves of electricity and magnetism. Light is an electromagnetic wave. That is amazing. No one saw that coming, not even Maxwell. How revolutionary is that? To unify two things and realize that there's a third entire branch of physics hiding in there too. Maxwell discovered light. And so looking back at Maxwell's work 150 years later, it's a shame he's not as well known as he is. He's one of my favorite scientists of all time because he's so smooth, so chill. He just comes in, boom, solves a problem and then walks out and then works on something else. He like studied the rings of Saturn after solving electromagnetism. Like just how, like he didn't even break a sweat. He's like, oh, interesting problem everyone has. Okay, here's some revolutionary concepts that nobody has ever heard of before. And there you go, that's how you explain electricity and magnetism. And look, oh, now there's light too. Who does that? Super geniuses of the highest order do that. He had an active imagination. He could think in mathematics. He was just smart, super smart. This is why Einstein himself admired Maxwell so much. Einstein didn't have a lot of pictures in his office. One of the pictures he had was a picture of Maxwell as a source of inspiration for him. Einstein geeked out over Maxwell. So if Einstein's going to geek out over him, I think we should geek out over him. Richard Feynman, the famous American physicist, Nobel Prize winner, said, when we look back at the 1800s, if you take the long view, like the 10,000 year long view, and you're recording, here's the one sentence to describe this century in humanity. He said, Maxwell's equations will come out on top, far surpassing any political event like the American Civil War or Napoleon or anything like 10,000 years from now, when our great-great-great-great-grandchildren say, so what did we accomplish in the 1800s? We'll say, we unified electricity and magnetism, and we understood what light was. Those were our big accomplishments in the 1800s, and it was all due to Maxwell. And think about Maxwell's contribution by uniting this, having this nice, compact, it's four equations, folks. Four equations describe, like, all the electricity in your home, the battery in your smartphone, the light you use that I'm using to light me and that you're using to see, sticking a magnet on your fridge, using a compass, the heat of a warm summer day, using radio, listening to the radio in your car. Electromagnetism is one of the most familiar and intimate forces to us, to humans. And we have Maxwell to thank for understanding it for us. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, please go to patreon.com/PM Sutter to keep the show going. I really do appreciate it, and I'll see you next week.